we were discussing the property of completeness that a metric space may or may not have. Let me recall that a metric space is said to be complete if every Cauchy sequence in it converges to a point in that metric space. And we also seen some examples of complete metric spaces and also some examples of incomplete metric spaces. Now, coming to the examples of complete metric spaces, we have seen that discrete metric space is always complete whatever be the underlying set X. And then the next set of examples that we have seen was that R and C, these are the complete metric spaces with the usual metric. And next we have seen that these spaces RK, CK, in fact a family of spaces, okay, these are all complete metric spaces. In the next group of metric spaces which we have discussed, let us look at the sequence spaces. Okay, these spaces LP, where 1 less than or equal to P less than or equal to infinity. Okay, it so happens that all these spaces are also complete. Okay. Let us just look at the space L1, and the proof will be more or less similar to the proof in the case of L1 in other spaces also. Okay, so L1, let us recall, it's a space of all sequences X from N to R such that sigma mod, let us say xk, k going from 1 to infinity is finite. Okay, that this is a convergent series. So to show that this is complete, okay, we'll have to consider a Cauchy sequence xn in L1, Cauchy sequence in L1. Okay. So if this is a Cauchy sequence, what we can observe from here is that or something that we have already observed, that this implies that for each j, xnj, this is a Cauchy sequence in R. Okay. If xn is a Cauchy sequence in L1, if you take the jth component, that will form a sequence xnj, that is a Cauchy sequence in R. And since we already seen that R is complete, this converges. So hence converges to some x, let us say to some xj in R. Okay, and this happens for each j. Okay, this happens for each j, so you get a sequence x going from n to r. Okay, for each j you have some xj. What remains to be proved is this new sequence x is in L1, this new sequence x is in L1, and this sequence xn converges to x in that L1 metric induced by this L1 norm. To do that, again we see that xn is Cauchy. This means that suppose you are given some epsilon bigger than 0, then there exists n0 in n such that if you take two indices n and m bigger than or equal to n0, then this means distance between xn and xm, that is less than epsilon. Okay, distance between xn and xm, that is less than epsilon. But what is the distance between xn and xm? It is nothing but norm of xn minus xm suffix 1. Okay, norm of xn minus xm suffix 1, right? And what is norm of xn minus xm? That is sigma mod xnj minus xmj. Okay, j going from 1 to infinity. This is nothing but what we had called, say, d1 between xn and xm, and this must be less than epsilon. Okay, this must be less than epsilon. Okay. Now the argument usually given after this is that keep some one n fixed. Okay, choose some one n bigger than or equal to n0, keep it fixed and let m go to infinity. Okay, let m go to infinity in this inequality. Okay, so doing that, what you will get is that this xmj will go to xj. This xmj will see this inequality is true for every m. Okay, suppose you keep n fixed, this inequality is true for every m, and hence it is true in the limit also. So that will imply that xmj goes to xj. So that will imply that distance between xn and x is less than epsilon. Okay, or in other words, it will imply that distance sigma mod xnj minus xj, that is less than epsilon. Okay, so what it will imply is that so we can say that letting m tend to infinity will get norm of this xn minus x suffix 1 that is less than epsilon, okay. That is keeping n fixed, that is choose some n bigger than or equal to n0, that is choose, let us say choose some n bigger than or equal to n0 and then let m go to infinity. Of course, this argument has to be made precise, okay, but it is okay. I think we are used to that kind of arguments by now. So using that we will get that norm of xn minus x is suffix 1 is less than epsilon, which means suppose we write it in the full form, it will mean that sigma mod xnj minus xj that is less than epsilon, okay. So in particular it will mean that this sequence xn minus x, that sequence is in L1, okay. That is, if you take a sequence xnj minus xj, that is in L1, but xn is already in L1, so that will give that x is in L1, okay. That will give that x is in L1. So this will say, for example, the x is nothing but we can say xn minus xn minus x, okay. And xn is in L1, this is also in L1, so this their sum is also in L1, so this is also in L1, okay. And again, this same inequality will show that xn converges to x. In fact, here we have shown that xn there exist n0 such that if you take any n bigger than or equal to n0, norm of xn minus x suffix 1 is less than epsilon. Okay, so that is the that shows that L1 is complete. Okay, L1 is, and with slight modification, you can show that all the other LPs are also complete. Slight modification of this proof will work for any other value of P also. Now, among the sequence spaces, the space which is not complete is the space C00, okay. Let us recall what was C00. C00 was the space for all sequences where all but finitely many of xn's are 0, okay. That is, for each sequence x, every sequence xn becomes constant sequence 0 after some time, okay. Those sequences which are eventually 0, okay. By the way, LP as well as this C, C naught, these are all complete, okay. All of these LPs as well as the sequence space C, that is the set of all convergent sequences, similarly C naught, the space of all sequences which converge to 0, these are all complete metric spaces, and the proofs will be more or less similar to what we have done now, okay. So among the sequence spaces, this C naught naught is an example of incomplete metric space. Of course, since C naught naught can be viewed as a subspace of any of these, we should decide what metric we are giving on C naught naught. Okay, suppose we regard C naught naught as a subspace of L infinity. Okay. Suppose we regard C naught naught, that means we are giving the supreme. Of course, we can as also regard it as subspace of L1 also. Okay. Right. Now, to show that a space is not complete, okay, there is only one way. You have to exhibit a Cauchy sequence. Give an example of a Cauchy sequence which does not converge, okay. Because till now we have only done that, okay. Subsequently, if we do, when we do some properties of complete metric spaces, then we can, another way of showing that a space is not complete will be to show that that metric space does not have that property, okay. But now we can only use the definition, okay. Let us take some example. Suppose we take say xn as this sequence, say 1, 1 by 2, etc. 1 by n and then 0, 0, 0, okay. That is, the first n entries are 1, 1 by 2, up to 1 by n, and subsequently the sequence becomes 0, okay. Right. So this becomes C naught naught, okay. This becomes C naught naught, okay. Now, first of all, we have to see that this is a Cauchy sequence, okay. We have to see that this is a Cauchy sequence, okay. Now, to see that this is a Cauchy sequence, again, as I said, since we are regarding it as a L infinity, we will have to look at the distance between xn and xm and show that for large values of n and m, that distance is small. Okay. Distance between xn and xm is nothing but this, okay. We are taking this suffix infinity norm. Okay. Let us take some, let us say m bigger than n. Okay. So xn is 1, 1 by 2, 1 by n up to 0, and xm will be 1 1 by 2, let us say 1 by m, and then 0 0 0. Okay. So what will be xn minus xm?
After 1 by m.
Yeah, that is, it will start from the first n entries will be 0, then 1 by m plus 1, sorry, 1 by n plus 1, 1 by n plus 2, it will go up to 1 by m, and then again 0, 0, 0. So what will be the norm of that? Remember, norm is, norm of any x is maximum of mod x, right? 1 upon n plus 1, okay, right? So this will be 1 by n plus 1, okay, right? So now, can that be made arbitrarily small? Suppose given any epsilon, can we always choose some n0 such that whenever m and n is bigger than that n0, this number becomes less than epsilon? That is true, okay, because 1 by n plus 1 tends to 0, so this is something we can always do. So that is clear, that this xn is a Cauchy sequence, in C00. Okay, but the question is, does it converge? Of course, it converges in L infinity. L infinity is complete. That is what we have seen. Okay, it converges in L infinity. It converges to, in L infinity, to which sequence? It will be the sequence 1, 1 by 2, 1 by n for all. Okay, and that sequence obviously does not belong to C00. Okay, right? Okay, that's clear. So in L, let us just, okay, xn converges to x. What is x? X is this sequence 1, 1 by 2, etc, etc, 1 by n, 1 by n plus 1, okay, in L infinity. Okay, so this element x, that is not in C00, okay, because in C00 what we require, that after some stage all entries should be 0. Right, that is not happening here. Okay. Now, can it converge to some element in C00 also? Obviously not, because that will mean that it converges to two different elements in L infinity. Okay. So we have shown, given an example of a Cauchy sequence which doesn't converge. So that proves that this space C00 is incomplete. Okay. All right. Now let us just look at the last group, namely function spaces. Here I will just make a small comment here, that is, we have looked at the space, let us say C01. Of course, we can take any interval A to B. Remember that this is a space of continuous real valued functions on the interval 0 to 1. Okay. And in, on this space, we had considered two different metrics. Okay. One metric was this, given by norm suffix infinity. Okay. So distance between two functions f and g was supremum of mod fx minus gx for x in 0 to 1. Okay. Now, with respect to that, this is complete. Okay. So, C01 with respect to this norm is complete. Okay. Okay. But this proof we shall do little later, okay, because the convergence in this particular norm or this particular metric is what is usually called uniform convergence. Okay. And we shall discuss the properties of uniform convergence of sequences, etc., a little later. So that time we shall prove that this space is complete. We'd also discuss one more norm on this, that is C0 to 1 norm suffix 1. Okay. What was this norm? Let us recall that norm suffix 1 of f, this was defined as integral 0 to 1 mod fx dx. Okay. And this is not complete. Okay. In this norm, it is not complete. Okay. So it can happen that the same set with respect to one metric can be a complete metric space, and with respect to some other metric, it is not a complete metric space. Okay. Now, how does one show that this is not complete? Again, you will have to give a sequence which is Cauchy but not convergent. Okay, I will not discuss those details here. I will give that to you as a problem. Okay. Okay. Now let us go to the next task. Namely, we shall discuss some properties of complete metric spaces. Okay. The first question is: given a complete metric space, we have seen that given any metric space, every subset can also be regarded as a metric space. Right? So suppose XD is a complete metric space. Complete metric space. Okay, and let us say Y is a subset of X. Y is a non-empty set, that is a subset of X. Then we know that Y also can be regarded as a metric space under the metric induced by the same metric D. Okay. Obvious question is, when is Y itself a complete metric space? Okay. Right? If Y is a subset of X, and if X is complete, when is Y complete? Okay. And the answer to that is very simple. Y is complete if and only if Y is closed. Okay. If Y is a closed subset of X, then it is a complete metric space. On the other hand, if it is a complete metric space, it is a closed subset of X. Okay. So that is the first theorem that we shall prove. Okay. Y is complete if and only if Y is closed. All right. Let us first assume that Y is complete. So let us look at the proof. This proof is fairly simple. Okay. Now, how does one show that any set is closed? Take a point in the closure. Okay. So let X belong to Y closure, and we should show that X belongs to Y. Okay. All right. Now we already discussed one characterization of a point in the closure in terms of sequences. Obviously, says whenever we talk of completeness, we should look at sequences. Okay. So, what do we know if X is in Y closure? What should happen? There is a sequence in Y. There is a sequence in Y which converges to X. Okay. So, this implies that then there exists a sequence of elements in Yn of elements in Y. Suppose I call that sequence Yn, say Yn, and Yn converges to X. Okay. Yn converges to X. Okay. Now each Yn is in Y. Okay. See, remember each Yn is in that is what the meaning of this elements in Y. That means Yn belongs to Y for all n. Okay. 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 Now Yn is a convergent sequence. Does it mean that it's a Cauchy sequence? Right? It means that it's a Cauchy sequence. Does it also mean that it is Cauchy sequence in Y? Right? Okay. So let us just say so. Yn is a Cauchy sequence in X, and hence in Y. Okay. And hence in Y, because the metric is same. Okay. Now we have assumed that Y is complete. Okay, that is starting point, and this Yn is a Cauchy sequence. Okay, so Yn must converge to some point in Y. Okay, right? So the argument is, since Y is complete, Yn converges to Y for some Y in Y. Okay. For some small Y in Y. Okay. Now, what is the obvious last part of the argument? Limit of a convergent sequence is unique. So, Yn is a sequence in X also. Okay. And X and Y both are points in X. Okay. So if Yn converges to Y and Yn converges to X, you must have X is equal to Y. Okay. So since limit of a sequence is unique, we have X is equal to Y which belongs to y. Okay, that is what we wanted to show, that x, we started with x in y closure and we showed that x belongs to y. Okay, so this shows that y is closed. Okay, all right. Now let us look at this way. Okay, assume that y is closed. Okay, assume that y is closed. Okay, and we want to say that y is complete. All right. Anyway, how does one start showing that any space is complete? Take a Cauchy sequence in that sequence, that space, and show that it converges. Okay, so let Yn be a Cauchy sequence in Y. Okay. And what is to be done is clear. Okay, it's a Cauchy sequence in Y, hence it's also a Cauchy sequence in X. Okay, because Y is a subset of X. Okay, so hence Yn is a Cauchy sequence in X. Okay, and hence X, since X is complete, Yn converges to some point in X. Okay, so since X is complete, there exists some y in X such that Yn converges to Y in X. Okay, and what is the next part of the argument? Yn converges to Y, and Yn is the sequence of elements in Y, so its limit must be in Y closure. Okay, okay, so this implies Y belongs to Y closure. Okay. Okay, but we assume that Y is closed. Okay, so Y closure is same as Y. Okay, okay. Just recall that we have started with a Cauchy sequence Yn in Y, and we have shown that that converges to a point in Y. That converges. Okay. Okay. So, for example, in the real line, any closed subset of a real line will be a complete metric space. Okay, so in particular, any closed interval is a complete metric space. Cantor set is a complete metric space. Okay, so take any closed set in any complete metric space, that itself will be a complete metric space. Okay, all right. Then the next important theorem in the complete metric space is what is called Cantor's intersection theorem. Cantor's intersection theorem, or in some books it is also called intersection principle. Okay, Cantor's intersection theorem. Okay. Now, to understand what is involved in this intersection theorem, okay, let me just introduce one more term here. What is called a decreasing family? Decreasing family or decreasing sequence of sets. Okay, decreasing family of sets. It is clear what is meant by this decreasing family. That is, suppose you have some family of subsets of X. Let us say these are n. Okay, this is called decreasing family if a1 contains a2, a2 contains a3, etc. In general, an contains an plus 1. That is, if a1 contains a2, a2 contains a3, etc. In general, an contains an plus 1. Okay. Now, what does Cantor's intersection theorem say? That suppose you have a complete metric space, okay, and if you consider a decreasing family or decreasing sequence of closed sets, and you assume one more condition, that diameter of Fn goes to 0, then intersection of Fn contains exactly one point. Okay, that is what Cantor's intersection theorem says. Okay, so let us first look at the statement. So let XD be a complete metric space okay, and let Fn be a decreasing family or decreasing sequence of closed sets such that diameter of Fn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity.
Okay.
Then intersection Fn, n going from 1 to infinity, is a singleton set. Okay. Intersection Fn is a singleton set. It contains exactly one point, is a singleton set. Okay. Now let us look at what are the hypotheses. There are three things assumed, that each Fn is closed. Okay. Okay, that is important. Each Fn is closed. Okay. What is the second hypothesis? That it is a decreasing sequence. Okay. That is F1 contains F2, F2 contains F3, etc. Okay. And the third hypothesis is this, diameter of Fn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. Okay. So under these three conditions we have to prove that intersection is consists of exactly one point. Okay. It consists, showing that it consists of exactly one point means what? First of all, it contains some point, it is non-empty. Okay. And secondly, it cannot contain more than one point. Okay. The second thing is little easy, that we shall prove first. Okay, that it cannot contain more than one point. Okay, and that follows from this last assumption here. So let us give some name to this intersection. So let us call it F. Okay. Let F be equal to intersection of Fn. N going. Of course, one more thing. Okay, it's a decreasing sequence of non-empty closed sets. Okay, that is also important because it is clear that if one of these Fn's is empty, then obviously intersection is going to be empty. Okay. So each Fn should also be non-empty. Okay. Each Fn should be closed. Okay. It should be a decreasing sequence and diameter should go to 0. Okay. These are all the requirements. Okay. All right. What can you say about diameter of F? Okay. How is diameter of F and diameter of Fn related? Okay, can we at least say this, that F is contained in Fn, right? F is contained in Fn. So what does it say about diameter, sir? So diameter of F must be less than or equal to diameter of Fn. So diameter of F is less than or equal to diameter of Fn, right? Okay. This should happen for all n, right? Diameter of F is less than or equal to diameter of Fn for all n. Okay, and we know that this goes to 0 as n tends to infinity. So what does it say about diameter of F? So diameter of F must be 0. Okay. So what it says is that diameter of F must be 0. Okay. And if diameter of F is 0, then obviously F cannot contain more than one point, right? Okay. So we have proved this second part, that is one part that is required. We want to show it contains exactly one point. At this stage it is proved that it certainly cannot contain more than one point. Okay. All right. Let us now show that it contains at least one point. Now, to show that it contains at least one point, okay, let us first use the fact that each Fn is non-empty. Since each Fn is non-empty, we can consider some point belonging to Fn. Okay, so we can say that let Xn belong to Fn. Let Xn belong to Fn. Okay. Then our idea is to show that, so this automatically forms a sequence. If you choose one Xn from Fn for each n, then it's a sequence. Okay. We will show that this is a Cauchy sequence, and then we'll use the assumption of completeness, okay? And using the completeness assumption, it will be possible to show that this sequence converges, and then we shall show that that limit should belong to F. Okay? That is the idea. Okay? Remember here, you know, F is a closed set. That is clear, right? It's an intersection of a family of closed sets. So F is closed. Okay, so we can, if you want, you recall it here. Okay, F is closed. Okay. Now to show that this is a Cauchy sequence, we use the fact, first of all, there are two things used here. Okay, first thing is that Fn is a decreasing sequence, and second thing is that diameter of Fn goes to zero. Okay. Now, if Xn belongs to Fn, can you also then see, let us look at Xn and Xn plus 1. So, suppose you take Xn plus 1, that belongs to Fn plus 1, right? Okay, that belongs to Fn plus 1, but we know that it is a decreasing family. So, Fn plus 1 is contained in Fn, so Fn plus 1 is contained in Fn, right? So, Xn plus 1 belongs to Fn also, okay, all right. And similarly, xn plus 2, x, all of them belong to Fn. Okay, so we can say that this set xn, xn plus 1, xn plus 2, etc., all of them are contained in Fn. Okay. Okay. All right. Now, if I take, let us say, any m bigger than n. Okay. If I take, so what it means is that if you take, say, m bigger than n, then xm belongs to Fn. That is what this says, right? Okay, all right. So suppose, so now if you xm and xn is anyway belongs to Fn. Okay, if you take m bigger than n, then in fact we can say both, that is xm and xn belong to Fn. Okay. And hence, what must happen is that if you look at a distance between xm and xn, then this must be less than or equal to diameter of Fn. Okay, this must be less than or equal to diameter of Fn, and diameter of Fn tends to zero. Okay, diameter of Fn tends to zero. Okay, does it prove that xn is a Cauchy sequence? Okay. Because since this tends to 0, given any epsilon, we can always find some n 0 such that diameter of Fn is less than epsilon for n bigger than or equal to n 0. Okay. And then the, for any m and n bigger than or equal to that n 0, distance between xm and xn will be less than that epsilon, right? Okay. So this shows that xn is a Cauchy sequence. Now we use this first hypothesis, okay, that is how we started. Okay, it's xt is a complete metric space, okay, and this is a Cauchy sequence in that. Okay, so this must converge. Okay, this must converge to some point in x. Okay, okay, and since x is complete, xn converges to x for some x in x. Okay. All right. Now we want to show that this x belongs to the intersection. Okay. This x belongs to the intersection. Now, how does one show that anything belongs to the intersection? There is only one way. We have to show that it belongs to each of these Fn's. Okay. All right. Okay. Okay. Now, x is a limit of the sequence xn. It's a limit of the sequence xn. Okay, is it also a limit of this sequence xn, xn plus 1, xn plus 2, etc.? Okay, right? For any, suppose you take any fixed value of n and take the sequence xn, xn plus 1, x, then that's a subsequence of the original sequence, right? So that's also, that should also converge to x. Okay, but all these points are in Fn, okay, and we assume that Fn is a closed set. We assume that Fn is a closed set, so each of these, so x must belong to Fn, okay, because x is a limit of a sequence of points in Fn, so x must belong to Fn, okay. So x belongs to Fn, okay, we can say that since this sequence xn plus 1, xn plus 2, etc., this sequence converges to x, okay, and this is this sequence Fn contains this, Fn contains this, okay, and Fn is closed, okay, x belongs to Fn, x belongs to Fn for all, okay, and that is same as saying that x belongs to the intersection, okay, okay. So have we proved everything? We have already proved that it cannot contain more than one point, and now we have shown that it contains one point. So intersection contains exactly one point. Okay, all right. So what are the hypotheses that we have used? We use practically everything. That it's a complete metric space. It's so each Fn is non-empty. It's a decreasing family, and diameter goes to zero. Okay, all right. Now at this point, let me. Recall, but I don't remember whether I have made this point earlier or not. That's a paragraph in the introduction of Simon's book, okay, where he says that any proof will, any theorem will contain some hypothesis and some conclusions, and a proof may contain several steps, okay. And suppose you understand how n plus one step follows from the nth step for each n, that does not really mean that you have understood the proof. Okay. You should understand a proof as a whole, as an idea. What are the main ideas involved in the proof? What is the way of really deciding whether you understood the proof or not? One way is you look at the various hypotheses of the theorem. Okay, here we have seen so many hypotheses. Okay, and then ask yourself whether any of these hypotheses can be dropped. Okay, that means what? Suppose to begin with, suppose assume that x need not be, x is not complete, but all other hypotheses are true. Then does the conclusion hold still? Okay, then you can say that just drop the hypothesis that Fn is a family of closed sets. Instead of closed sets, suppose you take the sets which are not necessarily closed. Okay, will the conclusion still hold? So do it for each of the hypotheses, okay, and see whether the theorem is still true. If it is, if the theorem is false, then for each such case you should get one example. For dropping one hypothesis, you should get one example to show that the conclusion doesn't hold. Okay, and if you can do it for all those hypotheses, then only you can be sure that you have understood the proof completely. Okay, so do it for this theorem, because this is the first major theorem that we have discussed in this course. Okay, so do it for this particular theorem. Okay. Now let us go to one more very famous theorem about the complete metric space. It is called Baer category theorem. Okay. Now to understand what is meant by Baer category theorem, we will again need some terminology. We have already defined what is meant by a dense subset, right? Okay, what is the meaning of dense subset? Okay, let us again recall. So suppose XD is a metric space, and let us say A is a subset of X. Okay, recall that we have said that A is dense in X. Okay. A is dense in X if A closure is equal to X. Okay, A closure is. Now we are going to define something that is exactly opposite to being dense. Okay, okay. We want to say, and we have seen that what is implied by saying that A is dense in X, among these so many equivalent conditions that we have seen, that saying that A is dense means if you take any open set in X. Okay, if you take any open set in X, it has a non-empty intersection with A. Okay, that is the meaning of. I mean that follows if A is dense in X. What is the exactly opposite concept of that? it means that if you look at, see, A closure is X, okay. Exactly opposite, that means A closure does not have any interior point, okay. So such a set is called nowhere dense, okay. So let us look at, let us see that definition first, okay. A is said to be nowhere dense. Said to be nowhere dense. Nowhere dense in X. If you look at A closure and look at its interior, that is empty. Okay, let us again see some examples before proceeding further with this, okay. Suppose XD is a discrete metric space, okay. Then we, if you take any subset, it is going to be closed, okay. Any, suppose let us take a non-empty subset, it will be closed, hence its closure will be that same subset. Also every subset is open, so its interior will again be the same subset. Obviously it will not be non-empty, so it will not be empty because you started with a non-empty subset. So in discrete metric space, no non-empty subset will be nowhere dense, okay. No non-empty subset will satisfy this property, okay. All right, now let us look at the real line. In real line, we know, for example, that set of all rational numbers is dense, okay. So Q closure is R, okay. Q closure is R, so Q closure interior will also be R, right. So let us just see, Q closure is R. So if I look at Q closure at its interior, that will be again R, okay, right. So Q does not satisfy this property, okay, though Q interior is empty, remember this, okay, fine, Q interior is empty. In fact, I think we have been using this notation for interior of Q, okay. So let me do it here also, that is interior of A closure. I think I have also mentioned that this is also fairly common notation used for the interior, okay. Okay. Now it is important to realize that if A interior is empty, that does not mean A is nowhere dense, okay, right. What must happen is that interior of its closure must be empty, okay. All right. Suppose we take, let us say N, suppose we take N, okay. What is the closure of N? N closure is N itself, okay, N closure is N itself. And what is the interior of N closure now? That is same as interior of N. And what is that? What is interior of N? That is an empty set, okay. So N is an example of a nowhere dense set, okay. And once you understand this, now you can construct so many other examples, okay. For example, Z is also an example of a nowhere dense set, okay. 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 So that is about nowhere dense sets, okay. Then let us look at the next concept which depends on this. We say that a set is of first category, okay. We say that set is of first category if it can be expressed as a countable union of nowhere dense sets, okay. Okay. We will say that. Suppose I call the set B, suppose let us say B is contained in X. B is said to be of first category, of first category. If B can be expressed as a countable union of nowhere dense sets. Okay. B can be expressed as a countable union of nowhere dense sets. Okay. Again, what is an obvious example of a set of first category in R? Okay. Take this set. Okay. Suppose you take any singleton. N can be expressed as a countable union of singleton sets. That is, N is, you can say N is union singleton N. Okay. Right. Okay. And if you take each singleton set, okay, its closure is that same singleton set, and its interior is empty. So each singleton set in R is nowhere dense. Okay. And so N is an example of a set of first category. Not only N, but you can say that since each singleton set is going to be nowhere dense, every countable subset of R is an example of set of first category. Okay. So in particular, for example, Q is also an example of the set of first category. It is not a nowhere dense set, but it can be expressed as a countable union of nowhere dense sets. Okay, all right. And if a set is not of first category, it is called second category. Okay, okay. Let us say so. If this is not true, it is B is said to be of first category if B can be expressed as a countable union of nowhere dense sets. Otherwise, we say that B is of second category. Okay, otherwise, B is said to be of second category. What does it mean? It means that it cannot be expressed as a countable union of nowhere dense sets. Okay. Another way of saying the same thing is that if at all you write B as a countable union of sets, then at least one of the sets occurring in that countable union should be not nowhere dense. Okay. Should be okay. That is the meaning of that. Okay, second category. Okay. Now coming back to bare category theorem. Bare category theorem statement is very simple. It simply says that every complete metric space is of second category. Okay. So let me just write that theorem here. Every complete metric space is of second category. Okay. Okay. So what does it mean? You cannot express a complete metric space as a countable union of nowhere dense sets. Okay, that's the statement of bare category theorem. It's a very useful theorem, and it is used in the proofs of many important theorems. But the only problem is that all those important theorems whose proofs use bare category theorem, you will not learn in the course of real analysis. But most of those theorems you will learn in functional analysis. Okay. There are many important theorems in functional analysis known as closed graph theorem and open mapping theorem, and also something called uniform boundedness principle. They are fairly important theorems from the points of view of applications, and the proofs of all those theorems use this bare category theorem. So we shall consider the proof of this bare category theorem in the next class. Okay.